Sometimes there are obstacles in the road that can leave you feeling low, and you don't know how to move forward. And sometimes there are turns you wanna take, but the way gets hard to trace. Now you're wondering, how did you get here? But don't you give up until you see how God is ordering your steps, so you can walk into your season. He that has begun a great work in you is faithful to perform. God is faithful to perform. He that has begun a great work in you is faithful to perform it. Our God is faithful.
Good morning, saints of God, NGL and friends. We're grateful to be here again on another Sunday. Amen. This is the month of June, and we're grateful that the Lord has blessed us. Amen. We are grateful to all that God has done and who He is in our lives. I pray that you all have had a prosperous, and I pray that you all have had a great and thankful week. We know that God is good continuously. We thank Him for strengthening and keeping our minds, and we love the Lord because He's always been good to us. And more importantly, He loved us first. And there's nothing like being loved by someone even when you don't deserve love. So we are grateful to God and for His love. So I just want to welcome you all, amen, to our Sunday morning worship service. We love to always start off with kind of sharing with you what we've been doing this past week. I believe it's important to just keep not only NGL updated, but anyone who's interested, amen, wants to be able to connect in different ways that maybe you haven't been able to do because we haven't been able to come together like we used to. But we still want to stay connected, and that's what we do. Every Tuesday, True Time with Pastor T, amen, we get an opportunity to come from our home to your home, amen, and just to kind of share a little tidbits that the Lord has dropped, amen. Some things are enlightening, amen. Some things will actually encourage, some will motivate, some will cause you to think, amen, and hopefully some will cause you to laugh. That is our goal and our endeavor, amen, during the week to continue to keep us encouraged. As well as our children's ministry. I just want to remind everyone, we've been talking about our children's ministry. I just kind of want to share with you all that they're constantly on the Class Dojo. So listen, what I'm grateful for is those leaders, they upload lessons, they upload activities for our children so that they can stay connected. So if there's ever a time that you're not sure what's going on with your children, they can always come into our Class Dojo and our children's ministry, and there'll be plenty of things to do while you're in Sunday school on Zoom, or even while you're at BUT, or even having a meeting, amen, on Zoom. We have stuff for our children, as well as our teenage Puritan age at 13 to 17. They'll also be on our Google Live classroom as well. I know they have been studying a great new study, great new book study, and it's important for us to keep them engaged, amen. That is an important age. Amen. That preteen age to 17, it's a lot going on in their minds, a lot going on in their heads, but we want to keep them connected and keep them grounded because that's what it's really about. Amen. And then every Thursday, 12 to 1, if you're feeling low or you just think you need a little praise or you need some prayer, our intercessory prayer line and intercessors are on the line from 12 to 1. Amen. The goal is for us to seek heaven, seek God, make sure that we're calling on Him. We need Him in times like this, and that's the type of God He is. He'll always be there for us and with us. But if you just need to hear that or you need to give a petition based on something going on in your life, our intercessors are there, willing to pray, open to pray, amen, so that we can continue to seek the Lord and all that He has and all that He wants to do in our lives. And then every Sunday at 8:30, Sunday school on Zoom, amen, multiple classrooms, amen, for our adults and as well for our children, amen, at 8:30. Great teachers, phenomenal teachers, take the time to study and to clearly articulate the Word of God and the truth of the living God, amen. And that's what we really want to do. We want to make sure that we're clear in Scripture, amen, that we are rightly dividing the Word of truth. And we have teachers that do that, amen. So I'm grateful that we continue to stay connected, amen. We have to always utilize the tools that God has given us, amen. And God has been faithful, and He's continuing to bless us, Amen. So I want you to remain confident in the Lord, confident in what we do. We can remain connected even until we get an opportunity to see each other again, which we will. Amen. But we want to be grateful and thankful for the platform that the Lord has provided for us to use. Amen. The other thing I just want to do just before we get ready to go into the Word, I want you to take this moment right now. I want you to subscribe to our YouTube channel. I want you to follow us. I want you to like us and share it with your friends and your families. If anything we've said or done that the Lord has given us has been helpful, has been inspiring, has been encouraging to you, share the Word of God. It is the Word of God that's going to keep us. It's the Word of God that's going to help deliver us. It's the Word of God that's going to bring clarity. It's going to help us know the roadmap and the desires that God has for us. So take this opportunity to share with your friends, amen, to share with your family members. All of us have people that we know need the Word of God. And this is that opportunity now that you can share that. Amen. As we prepare, bow your heads in your homes, in your cars, if you're on a jog or bike ride. Amen. As we seek God's presence. God, we thank you and we honor you. We love you because you've been good and you've been faithful to us. One of the greatest words is your faithfulness and how good you've been to us. You're always doing something, you're always keeping and always blessing. But we entreat you today, invoking your presence, asking you to move and to speak and to touch the people of God everywhere, to encourage their hearts and minds, to stimulate their minds, to cause them to think and want to see you better and see you clearly. God, we come to you first, acknowledging that you are our God, and without you, we are nothing. It is impossible for us to do anything. It's in you we breathe, live, and have our being. You are our God. You are the source of everything, not only the center of our joy, but you're the source of all things. And we appreciate you, and we ask you now today that you touch our minds and hearts, that you allow the presence of God to continue to shape around us, and that you anoint these lips of clay. God, remove us and hide us behind your cross. All that we do and all that we say, we want to be edifying and effective to the body of Christ. Not that we get any glory, but that you gain all the credit and glory. It is always about you. It has always been about you. And we want to continually make it about you. We thank you now for what you've given us, how you've shared your presence and your spirit. Now let the anointing do what only the anointing can do. And that is to destroy the yokes of bondage in and over our lives. And if you do so, God, we'll give you that much more praise. We won't stop, but we'll continue and we'll give you more because you graced us to do that. And we want to tell you and appreciate you just how good you are and how good you've been. Let the people of God say, thank God. Thank God. Amen. Amen. Let's turn to the word of the Lord. If you give me a few minutes, I won't be before you long today. I just kind of want to share the word of the Lord, some things that the Lord has spoken to my heart, to my mind concerning us. Let's turn to Colossians chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. Colossians chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. And we are going to be reading from the Amplified Version. Amen. Colossians chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. And we'll see what the Lord has to say to us on today. And the word of the Lord reads, let the peace of Christ, the inner calm of one who walks daily with him, be the controlling factor in your hearts, deciding and settling questions that arise. To this peace, indeed, we were called as members in one body of believers. And be ye thankful to God always. Verse 16 says, and let the spoken word of Christ have its home within you, dwelling in your hearts, minds, permeating every aspect of your being. And as you teach spiritual things and admonish and train one another with all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thanksgiving in your hearts to God. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and to the hearers and doers of his word. I want to speak from these words today. I want to talk about letting peace govern. I want to talk about letting peace govern. Letting peace govern. And the reason we're using the word let is because peace is an attribute that we have to allow. The Bible has already denoted that God has given us peace. He says, "Peace I leave with you, and peace I give unto you." And I'm not just talking about stillness. I'm not just talking about only a calmness. I'm not just talking about peace where we think it has to do with tranquility, where there's just no noise. But I'm talking about the peace of God that should really govern everything and every aspect of our lives, of our minds, of our hearts. It's the thing that the enemy constantly fights us on. It's the thing that the enemy constantly challenges us on mentally and emotionally and spiritually. And there are times when situations come upon us that things will try to shake or disturb your peace. It is becoming very prevalent. One of the reasons why so many people live in constant turmoil and constant under depression and oppression is because there is a lack of peace emotionally and spiritually in our hearts and in our minds. We're not satisfied. There's a lack of contentment. But peace is necessary, and it's the one thing we should be fighting for all we can. First of all, to keep it within ourselves. Because in order for you to extend and even exemplify peace, we have to first receive it. And that means we have to let it govern. And when I mean talk about govern, I'm talking about conducting policy in our life as the word of God sees fit. I'm talking about actions, affairs. You know, when something is governed, it operates and runs the organization or the people, but we have to allow the peace of God to rule our hearts and mind. This is what the word of the Lord says in Colossians. It says, "Inner calm daily, the controlling factor of our hearts, deciding to settle questions that arise." One of the reasons why we're disturbed all the time is because there's questions unanswered. And as I live and continue to learn, and you see in this life, there are some questions you're not going to always have the answer, but that doesn't mean you have to have a lack of peace. Because the Bible says that I can give you, God will give us peace that passeth all understanding. So even if we can't comprehend and we don't know why, accepting God's peace will allow us to walk in calmness. It'll allow us to walk fulfilled. It'll allow us to walk governed in our minds to where the enemy can't constantly disturb us. There is a disturbance, not only socially. And we are seeing, although we see outside aspects of it, it's been brewing a long time. There's been a lack of rest and a lack of peace, even in our country. And it just didn't start. I found out that it's hard to have peace over sin. You can't have peace in sin. The only way you can have peace is that means we have to release sin. That means we have to receive Christ. That means Christ has to be the unit in our hearts that change causes us to feel. Sometimes the reason that we've lacked peace is because we're constantly resisting God's way. But his way is the true right way. It's the only way to really govern and have the things that we desire in this life. I found out that you can have the money, you can have the job, you can have the career, you can have the so-called relationship, you can have the connections, you can have your network together. But when there is a lack of peace, it doesn't matter what you accomplish or what you obtain. If God is not in your heart, if he's not the center of everything, the center of your purpose or your control, it's almost like going back to basics with some of us. I believe we become we become such great theologians. We want to know so much. We want to search the scripture deep, high, and low. We want to try to figure out what God was thinking, but we're still missing the thing that he came to give us, which was salvation. And salvation gives us freedom and liberation from sin. And liberation from sin allows us to receive God's peace in our lives because we don't have to follow and operate out of guilt and condemnation, because God can rule in our hearts and he can give us understanding and clarity in our spirits that he is God. When you know God, we don't have to fear God when we know him.
There's a reason for fear, because we lack control, but we lack control because we won't let the Spirit of God, which we call the Holy Spirit, govern us. But it's important for us. It's why in Colossians 3 and 16, he tells us to allow that peace and that love to permeate in every aspect of our being as we're teaching spiritual things. And we're admonishing and training one another in God, that we're building one another up in the Spirit of the Lord. It's important to understand that the Hebrew word for peace is shalom. And it has a wide range, a systematic range, including the notions of totality or completeness. When I'm talking about having the peace of God, it means having success. Sure, we probably didn't know that. That's why it's important sometimes for us to really study and meditate the word of the Lord and study scripture and really try to understand God's broadness. Peace is not just having calm, but it's also having success. It means having fulfillment, wholeness. It allows us to have harmony, security, and well-being. It's what the enemy wants to keep us in fear of, that we lack security. But all security is really in God. There are so many things about God that we don't totally understand. And there are many things about God that we can learn if we have faith in him. Because everything that you believe, you're not going to always be able to comprehend. Faith has nothing to do about comprehension. It has all to do with you believing in God. But we spend a lot of time trying to comprehend. Listen, God is not a human. Jesus might have came in the human divine, but listen, God, there's nothing that's humanistic about God. Although he understands us, he is a God. And I don't know if we quite understand what that means. That means he's the creator of all things. It means he's the creator of the universe and every planet that's been created, every star that's put up. It means he holds it. He knows all. He's seen all. He's always been. It's never been a time that he hasn't existed. He's not someone that we can just go touch right away. We need to seek him and believe him, and we should depend on his presence. And really what that does is it means that we have to remain vulnerable. That's why peace is necessary, because it'll cause us to be complete. God's peace completes us. Not only governs us, but it completes us. One of the points I want to make is that it's important for God's peace to rule in our hearts. And we hear hearts often. And what I want to kind of bring to light is when the Bible depicts a heart, because heart is written in the Bible over 1,000 times, but it has multiple meanings. There's an in-depth meaning. When God talks about our hearts and letting peace rule in our hearts, he's talking about the control, our dominion over our hearts. This term and what it means, it stands for the inner parts of the person. When you talk or refer to heart, it's the inner part of that person. It refers to the will of an individual. Heart refers to the mind of the individual. The Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Did anybody catch that? As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. When God talks about the heart of us, the heart of God has a conscience. It has an intellect. It also deals with our emotions, because the Bible tells us to guard our hearts in Proverbs, because out of it flows the issues of life. It also has understanding. It is also referred to as a person's moral character. It's the determining factor of how we are, what we do, really how we feel, and even how we think about what we feel. Furthermore, the heart is the place of knowledge. Hallelujah. It carries knowledge. We love to use the saying, God knows my heart. But I'm here to encourage you that when God is in your heart, he'll change your heart, and everything else about your heart changes. See, there's no such thing as having a pure heart and a contaminated life. Those two don't link up, because when God enters the heart, he's not just controlling your feelings and your emotions, but he is controlling the very knowledge and concept and conscience a part of an individual. The heart of God denotes, and the heart that we have denotes memory and reflection. It allows us to remember the things that God has brought us over and to reflect on His goodness. This process takes apart not only in just our brain, but who God is. It's the center of who God is. It's why God is a heart fixer. It's why He lets us know that if He has not entered our heart, we have to be very careful, because our heart is deceitful and wicked, the Bible says. Who can know it? It can look like one way to us in one point, and then be something totally different on the inside. And I found out that if your character is tainted, so is our heart. That's why God is about a heart thing. He's about a heart fix. But sometimes the reason God can't totally rule our hearts is because we don't let the peace of God rule in it. We don't let His peace control us. We don't receive peace. We don't fight for it. It should be our life essence. You can't govern, or you can't live in this life without peace. People that live with no peace are disturbed. Sometimes you ask people, how can someone do this? How can you treat someone like that? We lack peace. When you lack peace, nothing satisfies you. In any part, there is no satisfaction. And what we do is we look for whatever matter we can, or whatever method we can, to try to bring us peace. But God is the one who gives us peace, and we have to allow Him to rule, totally control our hearts. Not partially share our hearts. Sometimes we treat God like old boyfriends and girlfriends, or old relationships. If something hurts you, we then, in the next one, we won't give totally all of ourselves. But with God, He wants all of us. And I understand clearly why He wants us all, because it's God's design and desire for us to live and walk peaceably with Him, so that we can always give God the praise that's due to Him. And also so that we don't constantly live in a maze, running around chasing something that's invisible, chasing invisible ghosts of our past, trying to rekindle something that's gone. But really having the peace of God allows us to move forward and say, God, I know that You have great things for me. I know that there's great things going on. I'm not saying it's easy, but with God, all things are possible. We're not talking about easy, we're talking about possible. Peace takes work. It takes work. It takes us to slow our minds down and meditate. It takes us to speak to ourselves in affirmation and remind ourselves of what God says, not only just about you, but what God says, period. It is important for us to not always, when we study God, look at God just for ourselves. We should look at God for what He says in general, knowing that this is what He's offered to everybody, so that we don't think we're the only ones fighting or lacking peace. But I want to encourage you today, let God have His peace. Let Him have His perfect work in our hearts. So allowing God to rule in our hearts, it controls the dominion of our hearts, the will of who we are, our desires, the understanding of God in our hearts, the knowledge of God in our hearts, His memory in our hearts. And that's how He wants us to rule. But I thought it was interesting. The other point I want to make today, which I think is very, very necessary, is to be thankful. I want to stop and think about that for a minute. To be thankful. To be thankful. Verse 15 in Colossians 3:15 ends telling us, and be thankful to God always. It's interesting that God would close out the same verse talking about the peace of God ruling in our hearts, and then end with being thankful. Thankfulness is the entrance of gratitude. It's the entrance of gratitude. It's the beginning process of developing gratitude. When we lack gratefulness, we lack thankfulness, because you cannot be grateful without first being thankful. And being thankful unto God always sets us mentally, emotionally, and spiritually in a place that allows us to share in God's gratitude in the things that He has attributed and given us in this life. When we lack thankfulness to God, we will always lack gratitude. And the lack of gratitude leads to a mindset of entitlement. And entitlement says, I should have and I deserve this. I don't deserve that. But being thankful unto God, giving Him thanks for who He is, not just for what He's done, allows us to enter the spot that God wants us to. It's one of the reasons why we won't have peace, because we're unthankful. People that are unthankful are not grateful, and they definitely lack peace because they're not thankful. Being thankful unto God doesn't mean that He's always doing what you want. That's control and manipulation. And if you only praise Him to get, you will never truly be grateful. And the thankfulness that you give is lip service. But the Bible says, it tells us, well, first of all, when we come to God, we must first know that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. But He is God. We have to give Him thanks, give Him praise for who He is. Not utilizing thanks and praise to try to play games and manipulate the Lord to get what we want. I understand the concept that the songwriter was saying, because there are so many parts of it that is true. There will never be a time when you thank God or when you praise God that you do not get the opportunity to share in God's goodness and God's glory. There's never a time when you praise Him that you don't feel His presence and don't feel who He is and what He's doing. So I understand clearly what it means to be thankful unto God. And I understand why the songwriter says, when the praises go up, blessings come down. But I don't want us to think by any measure or any mindset that every time you praise God that He has to give you what you want. Praise and thanks to God is what connects us to God. It's what keeps us, allowing us to experience His presence. It's also the part of our minds that helps us to think and follow God and know that He is good. When you're thankful, you're grateful. When you're grateful, you're able to live with gratitude. Gratitude means I can't complain all day and all the time. It's hard to be thankful, and it's hard to be a thankful person and then complain at the same time. Those two things don't share spaces. But if we continue to thank God, we have less complaints to make. And it doesn't mean that you don't want things, there are certain things you don't want change. It just means that you've understood and you've accepted that God is always doing great things for me. There's never a time where He's not doing great things for me. He's always moving. He's always speaking on our behalf. He is always speaking on our behalf. It's true. That's not a cliche. He's always speaking on our behalf. He's always thinking about us. He's always here to see about us. He's always with us. That's a promise that He's given to all of us, that He'll never leave us nor forsake us. That's not what the Lord does, but our thankfulness unto Him. It says a lot about our character, and it really allows us to have the gratitude we need in our heart. People that lack peace are ungrateful. Because you can't be grateful, and you cannot, you got, in order to be grateful, it's going to give you a sense of peace. It allows God to really rule in your hearts. I think when we hear the word grateful, for some people, we feel like in our minds that grateful is meaning that we don't desire more in the Lord. That's not what gratitude says. Gratitude says, I no longer feel like I'm getting the short end of the stick. It says that I am so grateful for what the Lord has given and allowed, because in all that he's done is doing great things. It's making me a better, not only a better person, but he's doing wonderful things in my life. Listen, God is always in the business of developing and redeveloping who we are. And this is the season and time in our life to allow God to push us past our levels of comfort and allow us to totally depend on him and to really thank him. And I'm here to tell you that there's sometimes when you thank God, it's how clarity really comes. You don't have to know what the next move is. You just have to know that I'm in God. And if I'm in God, he's got my next move already planned out. It allows us to feel the presence of God. And it's the presence of God that makes everything better. It's what makes things all right. It's the truth. It's one of the reasons why David said, listen, the one thing that I desire, and that will I seek after, is that I may dwell in the house of the Lord. It's something about dwelling in his house and in his presence. He says, I want to behold the beauty of who he is. I want to thank him and experience him and feel him in a way that shakes my core. You can thank God till you have an out-of-body experience, and God will show and reveal to you how great he is. You can thank him so that it goes past your physical and your natural being. You stop thinking about yourself solely as a natural being, and you understand the spiritual part of who you are. And it gives us the solitude and the peace that God is with us and for us. And that is what we have to live in this life and to transition in this life, to maneuver in this life from phase to phase, from faith to faith, from glory to glory. We have to have God's peace. His peace will cause us not to get out of character when something is challenging our character. Because that's the goal of the enemy. He wants to keep us, and not only the goal of the enemy, our flesh. People of God, allow God. Let him govern, fully govern all parts of our life. In our minds, the deep parts of our minds, the parts we hold secret, parts in our heart that we hold secret. You know, in order to hold a grudge, you have to hide it somewhere. And for many of us, we hide it in our heart. It's why God is always constantly preaching to us, speaking to us about our heart. Because you can hold a grudge that you might have forgot, but your heart didn't. Because when it comes up, you can feel it. And that means that there's unrest there, because there's no peace. I found out that you can't even fight or live in a state of truth or justice without really having peace. Because peace says that I've resolved it in God. I've allowed him to rule totally. And when I allow God to rule, it actually allows me to fight healthy. It allows me to live righteously, to preach the truth, to live the truth. Not because I'm perfect, but because of the perfection that I'm constantly going towards, meaning the maturity in God, to really allow God to govern everything in me. Not just who I am on Sunday, but govern who I am on Sunday night. And then who I wake up to become on Monday. And then govern my Thursday. Because that's who God is. That's what peace. Peace allows you to live in salvation with God day in and day out. And not go back and forth. I found out you can't run from anything. You can't run from problems, and you can't run from God. He'll meet you anywhere. If you don't believe me, ask Jonah. The Bible lets us know that Jonah tried to run from the presence of the Lord, and the Lord met him way out in the sea. And then he met him in the belly of a fish. We can't run from God. We can't. There's no running from him in any aspect. But allowing God to govern us. And we need his peace, saints. When there are certain things in this life that we walk through that just does not make sense. Certain things that we experience that we cannot comprehend. But when we live and allow God's peace to rule in us totally, it'll give us the fulfillment we need on the inside. And it'll allow us to constantly move forward and then see things with a different perspective. I pray God's peace in our minds and in our hearts, that it governs us, because it's what our world lacks. Peace is not always about being silent either. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about holding your peace when you know that there's conflict that needs to be resolved. That's not peace. That's quietness. The Bible denotes that God gives you peace that passes understanding. The peace of God has nothing to do with the lack of noise. It has all to do with the calmness and the inner joy that you have on the inside, even when the noise is around. Peace allows you to articulate clearly even your dissatisfaction without being harmful and having malice. When we have peace, we lack wrath. And the Bible denotes to us, anger and sin not. Don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Having peace doesn't mean that you don't get disturbed at times from times. It don't even mean that there's not times that you become angry. Having peace says that I understand that anger should be momentarily, and I should actually move past it. The reason I know that we lack peace is because it is too easy for many of us to hold that kind of anger day in and day out. That kind of emotion was not created to live day in and day out. It turns into something else. That's why we need peace. Having peace does not exonerate the accuser. It says that I don't have to live in that kind of pain, because of who God is. And that's what we should encourage. That's what we should want. People of God, we pray that the Lord has blessed and helped. And I want us to understand that this particular word, out of all that we preach and teach, salvation, holiness, all of these things bring that. But there's one thing I've learned in living for God, that peace is something that you have to allow God and allow Him to rule totally in our hearts. That's what it means, being peaceful and having God's peace. So I encourage you today, let us pray. God, I thank you and appreciate you for your people of God. I love you for who you are. I'm grateful that you have constantly been faithful and that you're constantly speaking to us. Thank you for bringing peace in our lives, teaching us how to allow it to govern who we are. The gospel of God, the truth of God. Pray now, God, that you go with us in our homes, where we are today. Help bring resolution and peace. Help us to receive your peace so that we can walk in you with security and fulfillment, knowing that you got our back. Help us to let go and relinquish anything. As the Bible said, lay aside every weight and sin that so easily beset us, and let us run this race with patience. We want to look to you. Give us the peace we need and help us to receive it, God. Help us to stop rejecting and resisting your way. Hallelujah, it's your way. It is your way. It's your way that we have to accept. And God, I pray now that you give us the things that we need. Let the people of God say, thank God. Amen. Grateful to the Spirit of the Lord. We love God. We appreciate you all. Listen, I want to thank you all. I want to thank NGL, all of you all, for constantly sowing. This is that opportunity where we get a chance to give. Thank you. You all have been great, continuing to utilize the platforms that we have. And I'm grateful. Amen. Your giving is necessary and it's important, and it's continuing to allow us to do all that we need to do for you and for the body of Christ. And it also shows victory. Giving unto God shows a level of gratitude to God, and it also shows commitment. And these are the things, believe it or not, that God honors and watches. He's a great provider. And if it's one lesson that I've learned, is when we stop allowing money to control us and govern us, the Lord doesn't have a problem with blessing us with more. When we look at it, what it's used for, it's a resource, just like food. It is our opportunity and our job to use the resource wisely and to use it to benefit the kingdom, as well as have some enjoyment yourself. But we should always make sure that we continue to do what we do, and that is showing God. He should be our first love and our first fruit. And NGL, you continue to do that every week. And I want to appreciate you and thank you from the bottom of our heart for what you do for the ministry of God. Amen. It is such a blessing, and it's so necessary, because there is such a need for God's people and God's ministry. Not just to preach salvation and to preach Jesus, but to teach Jesus and to live it. And as we continue to sow, it's going to continue to allow us to create avenues to benefit God's people in this kingdom. So I want to thank you all for your giving, your liberality, and what you do. The other thing I want to share, and I just want to appreciate, I want to just also let you know that it is such a blessing to know that we have a ministry that is so connected to one another. I thank you all for checking on families, checking on friends. That's what our job is, to show love to everyone that needs love and needs Christ. That's what we are, and that's what we want to continue to do. I want to close out with kind of just letting everyone know, once again, our hearts are still heavy. Amen. God is good, but our hearts are still heavy. Amen. To the lost, a great pillar, a great woman of God. Amen. Sister Annie Lyons, and to others, Sister McDonald. Amen. I just kind of want to share with you all and just kind of give some directives. Today, from 1 to 4 at Colonial Roses Funeral Home, will be the wake. Amen. So anyone of you in the community, if you want to get that opportunity to actually come in to the funeral home and visit her, amen, you got that opportunity to say your goodbyes there. Amen. That is open to the public, and we want to appreciate and thank the family for giving us that time. Amen. Thank them as we're praying for them, but just wanted to let you know that is from 1 to 4 at Colonial Roses Funeral Home. And then on Monday, amen, we are going to lay to rest this great woman of God. Amen. I just want to remind you that because of COVID-19, it's totally changed the way that we're governing and how we handle things. So on Monday from 10 to 11, that is only immediate family only. The capacity of our church, there's a certain number that we can hold, and we cannot go past that following guidelines, and we definitely are going to stay within guidelines. But that is specifically for that immediate family, and they know who they are. I want to appreciate them. That'll be a memorial service from 10 to 11, and we will also live stream that on our YouTube platform. So those of you that cannot come, would love to be, and I know that itself, because I know how we as saints love to praise and worship God when another saint goes home. Amen. But I want to make sure that what we're doing is doing all that we can to provide you with insight. And we want to thank the family for allowing and sharing that. That's something they're going to allow to be done. And then from 11 to 1, it is strictly a viewing. Amen. It is a public viewing. It will be in the sanctuary at New Burden Love, 427 East Fremont Street. Amen. In Stockton, California. You'll be able to actually come through, walk through, and view. Amen. And exit right out. Amen. Because we want to make sure that we respect the family, and we also want to give them their time to say goodbye. Amen. So from 11 to 1, amen, that will be the viewing. And that is for some of us as well. Sister Annie is family to us. She has a big natural family, but even spiritually, she is close and means so much to all of us. So just to, again, let you know, I want to make sure that we keep that. The 10 to 11 hour will be closed to anyone that is not immediate family. Amen. We will not be able to exceed the numbers due to COVID-19. But immediately at 11 to 1, there will be a public viewing that you will be able to take place in and walk through and say your goodbyes. Amen. We want to make sure that we respect the family and their time and pray for them. Amen. As they lay to rest. Amen. And then also Monday afternoon, we will lay this great woman to rest. Amen. So I just want to share with you, NGL and friends. I know many of you are asking and you just wanted clarity, but I just kind of wanted to share that. And I understand
to the fullest. Amen. But listen, we are still going to reverence and respect her because this is a woman's legacy that will not ever fade away. Her contribution and who she's been in this life and specifically in this church will never be forgotten. Her handprints are everywhere and all through it. Amen. And that is such a blessing. We all ought to live to be so impactful that we have changed the course in a positive way of so many people's life. Amen. So I want to appreciate you all. I want to thank you all. Continue to keep the family of Sister Annie in prayer. That's her spouse, her children, her grandchildren, her siblings, amen, cousins, friends, and church family. Keep them before the Lord, amen. And as we continue to see each other through live stream, as the Lord say the same, we'll see you all Tuesday on Pastor T True Time. God bless you all. Just repeat after me. God knows what he's doing, and he's doing it right now.